The Economic Policy Institute is a nonprofit, nonpartisan think tank that was created for the purpose of including the needs of low and middle-income workers in economic policy discussions. Today, we are proud to host this event in partnership with the Haas Institute for a Fair and Inclusive Society at UC Berkeley. On the occasion of the release of the Institute's first policy brief, titled The Path to a Fair and Inclusive Society, Policies that Address Rising Inequality. We think that EPI and the Haas Institute are very well aligned when it comes to the issue of reducing economic inequality in America. And we are very pleased to showcase this brief today and a few of the experts who have contributed to it. But before we hear from esteemed Haas Institute Director John A. Powell and our esteemed panelists for the day, who will be discussing rising inequality, it's my pleasure to first introduce you to our keynote speaker, Congresswoman Barbara Lee. A champion for the people, Representative Lee has proven time and again that she is willing to fight for working and middle-class families. And she is not afraid to speak up about Congress's need to find stronger policy solutions to help those in poverty. Dedicated to social and economic justice, international peace, and civil and human rights, Representative Lee is co-founder of the Congressional Out of Poverty Caucus, and in 2013, she became chair of the WIPS Task Force on Poverty and Opportunity. The mission of the task force is to raise the awareness of members of Congress and the American people about the ongoing crisis of poverty, as well as the need for a comprehensive national effort to eradicate poverty and remove barriers to opportunity that prevent low-income Americans from reaching the middle class. She serves on the powerful House Committee on Appropriations, House Committee on Budget, and the House Democratic Policy and Steering Committee. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming our keynote speaker, Congresswoman Barbara Lee.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much, and good morning. And let me just say, I know we're waiting on my colleague, Congressman Horsford. I had a red eye last night and wasn't certain if I could make it, and so I'm very pleased to be with you. Landed at 6 o'clock from the Bay Area, Berkeley, Oakland, and I'm really pleased to be able to be here. But I also just want to acknowledge Congressman Horsford, who will be here very shortly, because he has exhibited so much leadership in Congress and in his district. I've had the privilege to campaign with him. And he leads the Congressional Black Caucus's special orders on Monday night. And I tell you, he and Congressman Jeffries really do get out there on all of our issues and issue a clarion call on all of our behalf. So I just wanted to recognize him. I know he's on his way, but I may be on my way when he gets here, because it's a busy day. Let me thank you, Valerie, and let me thank the Economic Policy Institute for inviting me to be with you, and also Dr. Rocky Moore for her tremendous work and her timely and impactful work to address poverty, income inequality, and wealth disparities. As in my perspective, kind of say a couple of things in terms of the Haas Institute's report, responding to rising inequality. It should really be required reading for every member of Congress, and I will be sharing it with my colleagues. This report shows just how entrenched the barriers to economic opportunity have become over the last several decades. For far too many years, the American dream of a decent job and a better life for one's children has become really a distant memory, pushed out of reach by failed policies and misguided priorities. I know that our panelists are going to delve into the specific issues and the numbers, but let me just highlight a few of them that are very troubling for me. The national income received by the top 1% of U.S. residents has more than doubled over the last 30 years. That's doubled. With the share of national income held by 60% of the population with the lowest incomes has declined by 19% since 1970. And as we know, these struggles, these gaps, disproportionately affect women and people of color. Today, women earn only 77 cents for every dollar paid to men. The situation for women of color is even worse. On average, women of color earn only 64 cents for every dollar that a white man makes. In addition to wage-income inequality, women comprise nearly two-thirds of minimum wage earners, and we know that the current minimum wage is simply not a living wage. And I'm so proud of our low-wage workers and the mass movement that they're mounting, because no one should have to work and live below the poverty line. That is a shame and disgrace. And as Dr. Rockymore's recent report showed, there are major racial disparities in wealth as well. African Americans hold 6 cents in wealth for every dollar held by whites. The number for Latinos is 7 cents. Meanwhile, despite the economic recovery, unemployment rates continue to be much higher for communities of color, with African Americans at 11.4% and Latinos at 7.8%, compared to the national average of 6.2% in July. In my home district, in Alameda County, the Alameda County Food Bank found that 52% of its client households chose between buying food or paying for medical care. And as a member of the Appropriations Subcommittee on Labor, Education, Health, and Human Services, you know, part of what we have to do on the Hill is make sure that we not only continue to fight for the middle class, but fight for those who are fighting to become middle class. And so we can't just talk about preserving the middle class when you have millions of people struggling every day who are living below the poverty line and who are working very hard each and every day. And so we introduced a bill. It's a comprehensive bill, H.R. 5352, and it's called the Pathways Out of Poverty Act. The bill was introduced, I'm very proud to say, with 40 original Democratic co-sponsors. We're trying to make this bipartisan, though, mind you. It focuses on targeted and proven policies that create jobs, breaks down barriers to economic opportunity, and provide people a pathway out of poverty and into the middle class. Some of the provisions include an extension of unemployment insurance compensation, an expansion of the earned income tax credit, the expansion of pre-kindergarten to ensure that all low-income children have access to early childhood education, critical investments in job training for youth and adults, restoration of SNAP cuts that were made in the recent Farm Bill, and the establishment of an interagency working group to create a strategy to cut poverty in half in 10 years. In response to the rise in income inequality outlined in this report, I'm also really proud to co-sponsor, and I hope you look at both of these bills and talk about them today, H.R. 199. It's the Income Equity Act, which would deny tax deductions for employers for compensation to an employee, like a CEO, for example, exceeding 25 times the lowest paid worker at the company, or $500,000. In other words, corporations can pay their CEOs whatever they want, but taxpayers should not have to subsidize those huge salaries over $500,000. If in fact, and so the lowest wage worker, if it's 25 times that, no federal tax deduction. So taxpayers should not have to subsidize this. Unfortunately, though, in Congress, you know it's controlled by the Tea Party. It's true. And so, you know, these simple, effective, and evidence-based policy reforms have an uphill battle. And so we're trying to seek solutions. Of course, those on the other side remain obstacles, really, quite frankly. Many are fixated, and you can check this out. I'm on the Budget Committee and the Appropriations Committee, so just look at what's taking place. Many are fixated on Reagan-era trickle-down economics that have never worked and will never work, including slashing federal programs, block granting federal dollars to states that have already failed to properly administer them, and they continue to push through tax cuts for special interests to protect huge corporations that use loopholes to keep from paying billions in revenue. They're doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. You know what that means. They will, however, in their budget, and you look at the Ryan budget, and this is true, destroying the critical bridges over troubled waters for millions of Americans who are still struggling from an economic collapse enabled by these same policies. The stark realities outlined in your report call for real and proven solutions, not more of the same tired and, yeah, morally bankrupt policies wrapped up in new packaging. So I'm going to close now by saying once again that we've got to fight to eradicate poverty and create pathways into the middle class in the years to come. All of you really, Horsford, thank you again, Maya. Thank you, John, and welcome again to Washington, D.C.
So as you have now learned, we are blessed to have two members of Congress with us this morning, so we will hear from Congressman Horsford next. But before I bring him up, I just want to offer some introductory remarks. For those of you who don't know Congressman Horsford, he is also a strong advocate for middle and working class families. Elected to the U.S. Congress from Nevada's 4th Congressional District in 2012, Representative Horsford is the first African-American to serve in Nevada's federal delegation. But it's important to understand that he is not new to public service. Prior to coming to Washington, Congressman Horsford served in the Nevada State Senate and in 2008 became Nevada's youngest African-American State Senate Majority Leader. Representative Horsford serves on the Financial Services Committee and the Committee on Oversight and Government Reform, where he has distinguished himself as an astute leader willing to champion issues that support better economic security for vulnerable families. Ladies and gentlemen, we now welcome our second speaker this morning, Congressman Stephen Horsford.
Thank you and good morning. It's a pleasure to be with all of you here today and to join my colleague, a true champion for working people and those who are aspiring to be part of the middle class, Congresswoman Barbara Lee. I was about to call her Dr. Barbara Lee because she's so astute in all that she does. But she has been such a role model to me as a new member of Congress, and actually before I ever came to Congress, because of her work in the nonprofit sector and in social work and helping to actually impact lives. When we talk about grassroots, Barbara at the Haas Institute, and I personally want to commend and thank John A. Powell for your work on race, class, and opportunity in America, and I'm grateful that he and his colleagues are embarking upon an effort to bring their brilliant research from the halls of academia to policymakers across the country. We have a problem in America, and that problem is the toxic mix of extreme economic inequality and an era of great wealth. As the Haas Institute's policy brief states, the rise in inequality and its effect on economic mobility are defining issues for America's future. There is no silver bullet for inequality. Many things need to change. First and foremost, Congress needs to step up to the plate. And while we have many policy recommendations and we have proposed legislation for those of us who understand the problem, there is a partisan divide that runs parallel to the gap between the ultra-wealthy and the poor. There are some members of Congress who think inequality isn't an issue, that it is the result of the difference between laziness and hard work, that in the richest country in the world, even the poor must be doing just fine. They confirm orthodoxy. It is not a substantive solution to help those struggling to put food on the table and a roof over their heads during economic downturns. And when I hear my colleagues from the other side of the aisle arguing for tax cuts for corporations in one breath and cuts to social programs in the next, I really wonder what planet they are living on. Why would we subsidize the rich and pull the rug out from under the poor is beyond me. And research has shown that Reagan-era trickle-down economics has not worked, and that the politics of tax relief at the expense of all other priorities has proven bankrupt. Those social programs that are so often targets for the right are sometimes the last resort of support for the poor. Now, let me share something about why this matters to me personally. When I was a young man, I lost my father to a gunshot. My mother overcame being addicted to drugs. My grandmother suffered a stroke when I was just 9 weeks old and required around-the-clock care. Since I was a young boy, I visited my grandmother in a nursing home for every week for nearly 27 years until she passed away. I became the head of my household at a very young age. And at a time when I thought everything was falling apart, I was terrified. I knew that the deck was stacked against me, but it was only later in life that I saw how dire my situation truly was. I'm a poor kid who grew up in West Las Vegas, who had lost my dad, who was in the process, I thought, of losing my mother. She's now clean and sober, going on 20 years, who had no one to look out for him, or at least I thought. I thought I was going to become a statistic. You may have heard the words, the food stamp challenge, where members of Congress live on SNAP benefits for a week. Well, at one point in my life, I lived that challenge for real. But those benefits put food on the table. My brother and my two sisters. My grandmother, I did not understand this until later in life, but the only reason that she was able to get the medical care she did in that nursing home for 27 years was because of the disability programs under Social Security that are required. And while moving from nursing home to nursing home was hard, we had some support. And as I said, my mom is now clean and sober and back on track, thanks to intervention and community-based programs. I made it because people gave me a hand up when I needed it most, when they didn't even know me, when they could have turned away. So I come here today not as a defender of the federal government or every federal agency, but as a defender of the programs that improve the lives of millions of Americans every day. I am a defender of public programs that work, the types of programs discussed in this report. We can improve government, but one thing's for certain, there's no justification for adding to administrative costs and reducing safety net services for those who need it most by ceding federal poverty money and authority to the states. And our recent local, state, and national tax coffers were laid bare by the Great Recession, a situation exacerbated by decades of tax breaks that made it even more difficult for state governments to weather the economic storm. So the first step Congress needs to take is to admit that there is a problem. This report states that problem loud, clear, and certain. The national income received by the top 1% of U.S. residents has more than doubled over the last 30 years, while the share of national income held by the 60% of the population with the lowest incomes has declined by 19% since 1970. As they point out, this inequality is not the inevitable side effect of capitalism, inclusive of all families. I stand here today because of programs that helped me. I didn't slip through the cracks. It was a good combination of perseverance and a whole lot of blessings. One misstep along the way, and I wouldn't be standing before you. Things out of my control could have derailed my life. That's a reality. And there are millions that share my story who are not nearly as fortunate as I am. Who are all still struggling today. It's time for Congress to wake up and recognize that reality, and I want to thank all of you for being here and doing what you do to push us to fulfill the purpose that this Congress should be living up to. Thank you very much for allowing me to be here today.
Okay.
It's on. Good morning, everyone.
Well,
we just heard some very compelling information from intimate, compelling information from some of the highest leaders in this nation, Congresswoman Lee from California, as well as Congressman Steve Horsford. Sometimes we have technical difficulties. It's called a hot mic. And that we have a hot mic moment. But nonetheless, poverty is something in this nation. Disparities are pervasive in this nation. In almost every sector of this nation, we find some sort of disparity. And to talk about disparities today, first of all, before we even talk about it, I want to thank Dr. Maya Rockymore for allowing me to be your moderator for this great panel discussion today. My name is April Ryan. I'm White House correspondent and Washington Bureau Chief for the American Urban Radio Networks. And I find this topic fitting because every day I'm peppering the President of the United States and his mouthpieces about issues of poverty and disparities. So without further ado, I want to introduce our panel. We're joined today by John A. Powell, director of the Haas Institute for Fair and Inclusive Societies, the professor of law, African American and Ethnic Studies at UC Berkeley, Hillary Hoynes, professor of public policy and economics, the Haas Distinguished Chair of Economic Disparities, Richard and Rhoda Goldman, School of Public Policy, UC Berkeley co-editor, American Economic Review, and Michael Reich, Professor of Economics and Director of the Institute for Research on Labor and Employment at UC Berkeley. Let's give them a big round of applause. I want to present you with a fact. That America has structural problems when it comes to wealth and income inequality, with the richest 20% of the population holding over 89% of the nation's wealth. There is no doubt that we have an economic imbalance. If left undressed, it could have dire consequences, as we heard from the congressional leaders, for our nation's future. So when we talk about the disparities, there is a problem with economic mobility. So let's delve into this issue, and I want to start with John. John, tell us about the Haas Institute and why you chose inequality as the first subject for this first policy brief of the Haas Institute.
Well, thank you for the question, and thank you for moderating.
Thank you.
And for the work that you do. And again, I'd like to join in thanking Dr. Maya Rockmore. It's a delight to work with you and EPA for help hosting this. The Haas Institute is unique in a number of ways. What we're trying to do is take cutting-edge research at Berkeley and around the country and making it really involved in policy issues and in solving what seem like intractable problems. It's seven clusters. The economic disparity cluster is one cluster headed by Dr. Hillary Horn. And we do research that actually affect real-life people, and we go beyond that. The seven clusters deal with all kinds of social cleavages, about 100 researchers at Berkeley, but we also deal with race, disability, religion, of course, inequality, And we're trying to bring all that together and in a coherent way so that to make real changes in America. And we work closely with community groups, with policymakers, and with folks who know how to talk to the average American, so communicators. So that's what we're trying to do, and it's new. And I'm pleased to be the first director of the Haas Institute.
Congratulations. So when we talk about inequality, it's a very complex issue. And many people really don't understand the dynamics of it, and maybe even some people in this audience and watching. Could you break down the construct of inequality when it comes to race, income, poverty, and mobility?
Yeah, so as everyone knows, the idea of equality is actually enshrined in the American Declaration of Independence. And different countries sort of approach equality in different ways. And one of the things the United States maintain is that while we're not focusing on equality of outcome, we are focusing on equality of opportunity, that we, for years, prided ourselves as the country where there is the most mobility, where everyone had a fair chance. Now, obviously, that wasn't true, but that was the aspiration. And it was the aspiration that for many years we moved closer and closer toward, certainly from the 1930s to the 1960s. As the country grew, as the economy grew, it grew faster in the lower quintiles. That's changed since the 1970s. As the economy has grown, it has not benefited those in the lower quintile. So we have actually three related problems. We have in growing poverty, we have a shrinking middle class, and we have growing wealth inequality and income inequality, and then it's unevenly distributed across the country. A lot of times we assume that inequality of a certain nature actually support economic growth. There's a growing consensus that that's no longer true, that the growing inequality, both in terms of wealth and income, is actually retarding economic growth. And the International Monetary Fund just issued two reports showing that the growing inequality in the United States and the world is retarding economic growth. And as the Congress, both Congress people said, it's not a result of just the market or technology. It's very concrete policies that the country has adopted, and it's uneven across the country. There's some places where people do better because they have better programs, better schools, less segregation than others. And then there's specific things we can do to start turning this around. And Dr. Horn and Dr. Reich will actually talk more about that. Some of the things we've done have been relatively good, like the Earned Income Tax Credit, like trying to address minimum wages. So part of it is to really bring this to American attention and understand that if we continue down this road, it's not just hurting blacks, Latinos, Asians, Native Americans, or poor whites. It's hurting the entire country. It's actually undermining our democracy, it's undermining our economy, and it's undermining American ideals.
I want to take one point, extract one point you just said. You said the IMF says that the American inequality is affecting the global community. Is that what you just said?
Yes, the extreme inequality that America is actually the epitome of is actually retarding the growth and sustainability of the economy, both in the United States and the world. And think about it. I mean, one of the things, the economy, 70% of the economy is actually a consumer economy. It's people's ability to buy. And we're seeing more and more people not being able to participate as consumers. Also, when we invest in people, we're investing in new growth of the economy. It's the most important investment. And the way we do our schools now, the growing segregation, we're not just leaving people behind in schools. We're leaving them out as productive citizens and as productive producers.
Let's go to the issue of challenge of poverty in America. And I want to talk to Hillary about just how bad it is. We just heard Congresswoman Lee talk about some people in her district in Alameda County say that they had to choose between food and paying rent. And then we heard the life story of Congressman Horsford. And could you talk to me about the poverty rates in this country compared with other Western industrialized societies and the implication of rising inequality for those who live in poverty?
Sure, thank you. It's great to be here today and to be part of this panel and leading this cluster in the activities that we'll be talking about today. So, you know, as was mentioned by both Congressman Lee and Congressman Horsford and echoed by John, inequality, we can think about inequality as really being characterized by what's happening both at the top and at the bottom of the income distribution. So there's much attention to the work by our UC Berkeley colleague and Haas Institute member, Emmanuel Saez, who with his colleague Thomas Piketty has really established the basic facts about the concentration of income at the top of the distribution that has been well cited today. At the flip side of that is what's happening at the lower end of the income distribution, and poverty is our standardized national statistic for measuring what's going on at the lower end of the income distribution. And for decades, the United States has been an outlier, both in terms of its concentration of income at the top, as well as the propensity to have households with income that don't meet basic needs, which is the definition of poverty. So to put some numbers to that, an OECD recent report has the United States at the very top of the list of OECD countries as to our poverty rate at 17%, much higher among children. This is among all people. That poverty rate is higher than countries in the OECD, such as Greece and Spain, which are experiencing incredible distress in the Great Recession, compared to maybe some of our peer countries. France, Germany has poverty rates at between 7.5%, and Sweden at much lower than that. So the United States has a high rate of poverty. One of the things that we want to talk about today, in echoing your introductory comments, April, is that this is not an inevitability. And one of the things that we know, both about the characterizing rising inequality and the concentration of income at the top of the distribution, as well as the real persistence, I wouldn't say rising, I would say persistence, of poverty at the low end of the distribution is that policies matter. And in our comparison with other countries, we can point to policies that make a difference, as well as the policies that we currently have in the United States that could be improved and that have a success rate at keeping poverty lower than it would be in the alternative.
And Hillary, I like what you said. You said persistence. Mm-hmm. A lot of people think it's something new.
Right.
Or it's just been there, I don't have to deal with it. But when we talk about persistence, you know, we heard about the war on poverty.
Right.
You know, with LBJ, we heard about the March on Washington for Jobs and Justice. And that was like just 50 years ago, and it was even prior to that. So when you say persistence, this is something that continues and continues until something is done to change it, correct?
Right. I mean, just to cause a point to that, if you look at the trend in poverty over time, you could basically characterize it as initial striking gains in the wake of the war on poverty, and then persistence. And a lot of people look at that, and you know, central in you know Paul Ryan's proposals and whatnot, is the fact that, wow, we're pouring all this money into these programs, yet poverty is persistent. That must mean that the policies are failing us. But what that misses is in the background of that persistence, and something that you know Michael's really an expert on and we'll talk about more in his comments, is the loss of wages, real wages, for less skilled workers. So yes. That persistence, strangely enough, is a little bit of a success because the biggest driver for poverty is low wages.
And underemployment
as
well.
Underemployment.
Yeah, so...
Would become lower and lower and lower, and the proletariat would be impoverished. He really had a much more sophisticated analysis than that, and said once we started having regulation, for example, a limit on the length of the working day in the 1860s, that wages would start to rise. Not for everybody, that there would be inequality within the labor market, but that and since that time, there's been increasing number of regulations. Labor market is very regulated. We have a minimum wage, you have maximum hours before overtime. We have health and safety standards, child labor standards, and so on. And as a result, the labor market has worked to create rising living standards for much of American history since the regulatory period began. So until the late 1970s, when productivity was rising, wages were rising in the same amount, and they were actually rising a little more for people at the bottom than at the people at the top, but they were rising for everybody, and that's the old John Kennedy quote that I remember him saying, you know, the rising tide lifts all boats. And something changed since then. I don't think it's so much technology or globalization. Indeed, Larry Michel here at EPI has done some very good work with other colleagues showing that automation and the disappearance of a lot of routine jobs, which has undermined some sectors of the labor market, really doesn't account for very much of the growth in inequality. It's not, we do have polarized job markets, but not necessarily for that reason. The same is true of globalization. The lowest wage sectors in the United States are, well, we know from the people who are demonstrating, are fast food workers. That's fast food. Childcare is pretty low, too. Those are not sectors that are affected by globalist competition because of globalization. That's those wages could be higher. Indeed, they are higher in Europe despite globalization. So it's something about something either specific to the United States, this economy, or the policies. I think it's the policies. The scholars who have looked at the growth of inequality in the United States and the fact and try to understand, well, why have wages stopped growing even though productivity has continued to grow, point to a couple of answers. One is the decline in unionization, which a Congress member from Nevada knows a lot about because he was very involved with that and the culinary workers in Las Vegas. A second one is the decline in the minimum wage, which used to be equivalent of $10 or $11 in the 60s. And today, most low-wage workers are much more educated. They're more likely to be adults and teens than in those days. And overall productivity has gone up. So something changed. The minimum wage used to be one of those reasons why the rising tide lifted all the boats, because it was going up at about the same rate as the average wage was in the 50s and 60s. And that's no longer the case. It was, say, 50, 55% of the median wage until the 70s. Today, it's in about 35 or 36% of the median wage. So we have really deteriorated, not just in the level of the minimum wage, but also its relationship to the average wage. And then another factor that's often pointed to, and I think correctly, is the decline in the tax rates of the very top. All those tax cuts. Saez is very good, I think, at showing that those tax cuts have not led to more economic growth. That other countries have not cut their taxes at the top so much, have grown as much as we have. Mm-hmm. So that's like what we call a rent, not a productive activity, but a share of the national income that's being captured by the people at the top. Why is that so important? It's not because we envy them and so on. It's because when you lower the tax rate at the top, greed sets in, and you say, well, I can actually keep a whole lot of what my higher income is. That wasn't the case under Eisenhower. The nominal, not the effective tax rate, was 91% at the top. It was more like 70%, the effective tax rate. But that's still unheard of today. And so a group that says, well, we didn't, in the past, we couldn't keep most of it, so we're not going to do outrageous things in our executive compensation suites and so on to get higher pay. But now that is a problem. And so I think you can see that in the research literature on how compensation gets set, it's not set by performance, but more by a group of people who are. You might need to know something about elementary statistics. But those where we're getting into policy questions where education can really make a difference.
Thanks, Michael. I want to now move into racial inequality and talk about the economics of black and brown people in this country. So, John, I want to ask you, what is the construct of racial and ethnic wealth gaps, and why should it be a part of the conversation in addressing the rising inequality in this country?
Well, that's a great question. And let me just comment on the question you just asked Michael. If you think about in the middle of the 19th century, almost 90%, 90-plus percent of Americans were farmers, right? So because of technology, now it's almost down to, what, 3%. And so we did lose people in the farming sector, but they went into other sectors. There's a transition. During that transition, you need different education, and you need a pathway to soften it. We're not doing that right now. So while we train people, while people are thrown out of work, and there always will be that when there's new technology. And so you're having, how do we share the change? We're not doing that right now. So I think Michael is correct, but I think what we're not doing is saying, let's make this transition smooth. And so it's not harmful to people who may be thrown out even while we create new jobs. So race is actually a big part of understanding this problem, and I've written a little bit about this. Both Saez and Piketty have written about the polarization in terms of the economy, wealth, and income, which really took off sometime in the 70s. But they remind us that this polarization of the economy was preceded by economic polarization. And the economic polarization, which basically means the country is fighting and divided economically, started really in the early 70s. The country started being polarized. We also got a new alignment in the country, which we don't think about. We call it the Southern Strategy. The South was solidly Democrat when Johnson ran for president. Mm-hmm. In the 70s, it became solidly Republican. In the 1930s and 40s, the South was solidly supportive of unions. In the 1950s, it was solidly opposed to unions. And a lot of that was racially motivated. So the racial motivation for creating some of these draconian policies was sometimes racial hostility, especially coming from the South, that essentially has actually defined the entire country. And you're actually going to see more of that, even though people don't talk about it. So it's not just how black and brown and Asians are affected by the policies, because all of us are affected by it. And when you look at where there's deep racial segregation and deep racial polarization, primarily in the South, but not just the South, the actual mobility is actually depressed for everybody, not just blacks or Latinos, everybody. So this polarization actually hurts us all. Having said that, when you think about wealth, and wealth is obviously, a lot of it's inherited, and again, shown a lot in Piketty's new book. So we're talking about inherited opportunity and inherited disability. If you think about housing, housing is the major market for middle-class Americans to actually accumulate wealth. Well, blacks essentially were locked out of the housing market to the 1950s or early 60s. And so when you looked at recently what happened in terms of the housing crisis, it was complicated. There was actually a large influx of capital in the world, and Alan Greenspan directed that capital largely to the housing market. The housing market in the United States that was underdeveloped was the black and brown housing market, because the white housing market was more or less a mature housing market. And we had huge, literally trillions of dollars being directed to that market. That's not bad in of itself, but it's directed in terms that were unfair to those communities through subprime loans and predatory loans. And when those loans exploded, for a whole bunch of reasons, a lot of it squarely on the hands of the banking industry itself, it actually ripped resources out of those communities. So while the entire country suffered, the black and Latino community suffered the most. And so the wealth inequality went from 10 to 1 in the black community, or 9 to 1 in the Latino community, to 20 to 1. And it happened really while President Obama was in the White House. But there's been no policy interventions. In fact, the policies that are being debated in Congress would push blacks and Latinos further out by having a dual credit market. And so we know that the country is moving to a more diverse country. You can't have large sectors of the country left out of the market and have a thriving market, even if you don't care about blacks and Latinos. Half the children born in public schools today are non-white children. If you don't educate those children, it means you don't have an educated workforce. So all the mechanisms for creating wealth is actually argue that that is what propelled the United States to become the number one economy in the world. Well, if you think about that, more than half children in schools today are children of color. So if we decide to leave those children behind, again, we're playing with half a deck. And so if we're going to be an economic engine in the future, we can't leave large sectors of the economy behind, both from an economic perspective. And then think about the politics and what this means in terms of democracy. It's simply not sustainable. And so we need a policy that actually lifts all of us up. And it's something I call target universalism. And I like the idea of a rising tide lifting all boats, but we need to recognize that some people don't have a boat. Mm. And so...
I don't.
So we need to make sure, first of all...
I have a bathtub.
What'd you say?
I have a bathtub.
You have a bathtub, okay.
And then just one other thing, and we're actually thinking about this right now, the way we've done with not just with school segregation, housing segregation, credit segregation, but also think about the criminal justice industrial complex, the way that has also distorted the country. So part of the thing we try to do in this report, which is different, is that we're not looking at a single policy. Mm-hmm. All these things are interactive. And I think if we look carefully, we see most of them have a racial component, and sometimes in not obvious ways. But we need to be mindful of that and be aware of how different groups are situated. And we shouldn't get into a thing of, well, if you're talking about race, recognizes that, and you need a different policy in terms of race, not because race means that you're essentially different if you're black and white, but we're essentially located differently within our structure. And so we have to locate how those differences matter in terms of reaching that goal of being a full and productive member of society and being a full and productive citizen. And in doing that, the last thing I'll say is that we have to pay attention to what's happening at the top. Because the depressing life outcomes is not just depressing life outcomes of people of color, it's actually depressing life outcomes of middle-class whites as well. We're seeing the middle class shrink. Mm-hmm. For years, our goal was to get into the middle class. The middle class is going away, so we need to have a policy that recognizes that as well. Mm.
I want you all to get ready because we're going to, and prepare yourself for questions, because it's a very stimulating conversation. If you want to ask any of our panelists some questions after this round of questioning that I have the privilege to do with them, please. Be ready for some questions because we're going to come to you. But I want to go back to Michael. Michael, what about economic mobility? And what is it? Do we have it? And if not, how do we get it?
Good question. It sounds like something good that we want more of, right? I distinguish between two kinds of mobility. There's career mobility, which is intergenerational. That's what's in a generation. From the time you start in the labor market to, say, by the time you retire, how much have you been able to move up, right, given where you started? I think what we're talking about today, though, is much more intergenerational mobility, giving kids an equal chance. That's the equality of opportunity. And economists like to measure it by looking at the correlation between where a parent, a father or a mother is relative to the son or daughter in the economic income distribution. And it turns out in the United States that correlation is very, very high. That is, if you chose the right parents, the article I once wrote, or rich parents, you're going to do a lot better. And that's partly inheritance. That's certainly part of it. But it's also other advantages that parents provide. Some of them are prenatal and some are in early, before you get to kindergarten in terms of your vocabulary or ability to develop parts of your personality. And some are providing extras, whether it's summer camp or whatever, after school programs and paying your way also through colleges and universities. And we used to think of the United States as a country of equal or highly equal opportunity and mobility, but now we have a lot of cross-country studies and we find that the U.S. ranks very low in intergenerational mobility. Mm-hmm. And that makes the problem of inequality of outcome even worse, because if you had a lot of mobility, if this race were fair and we still had a lot of, you know, some people capturing much more of the income distribution, say, well, at least it was a fair race. But that isn't the case at all. Indeed, the countries that have more inequality of outcome also have more inequality of opportunity. So the two are linked. We don't completely understand why, but it's certainly part of it. How can we get more mobility? Obviously, we could do better taxing inheritances than we do. And then there's a whole series of programs of which John was starting to refer to.
Wow, interesting conversation. Hillary, I want to talk to you about expanding the EITC. Now, expanding the EITC is one of the recommendations in the brief. Paul Ryan actually made a similar argument in his recent anti-poverty plan, but can you explain why it's important and whether there is a possibility of a bipartisan compromise on this policy?
Sure, I'd love to. It's something I've been doing a lot of work on over the past couple of decades. Before I talk about the EITC, I wanted to add one thing to Michael's excellent kind of description about mobility in the United States, and just to point out that this is not a constant factor across the United States. So some of the new path-breaking work by, again, Emmanuel Saez, and the whole story, but policies seem to play a role there.
Now, I mean, I'm shocked to hear about Charlotte, and I'm the reason why I said
I didn't want to, like, I'm sure there's some Charlotte people
shocked.
In the audience.
No, because
the fact.
The Democratic convention was held there, and it's an up-and-coming city.
Right.
I mean, they're bringing a lot of infrastructure. They're building up that city, and I'm surprised to hear that.
Right. So we're going to learn more about that. This is really new data that's allowed us to measure these things at a more finer geography. And the hope in that is that we learn something about what the levers are. And this is really just made available by great minds and great data.
All right, let's go to
EITC.
Yes.
So the Earned Income Tax Credit is kind of amazingly one of the only elements of the social safety net for which there's been a reasonable amount of bipartisan support. Why is that? What is it? Why is it important? And why is it not the only thing we need to help raise incomes at the bottom of the distribution? So the Earned Income Tax Credit is part of the U.S. tax code. It's a credit, a refundable tax credit. Most households that receive it as a tax refund. And what it essentially is an earnings subsidy. And at the core of why it's received bipartisan support is that, number one, it's highly targeted, and it's focused on individuals who work. So no earnings, no EITC. So what the program does is increase after-tax incomes of households primarily with children in the United States, pretty much around between 100 and 175% of the poverty line is where most of the supplementation is strongest. And the research that's been done on this program shows that not only has it increased after-tax incomes, after Social Security, it's the largest anti-poverty program in America. A lot of people don't know that. About a little less than 5 million children are raised above poverty because of the EITC, and millions more individuals overall. So it's highly successful at supplementing income, targeting a particular range of income, given the structure of it, while, and here's the kicker, while also incentivizing work. And it's that bundle, I think, that makes it of more bipartisan support, as evidenced not only most recently by Paul Ryan's endorsement of expansion, but the initial expansion of the EITC occurred under President Reagan in 1986. Secondly, by Bush 1 in 1990. Most emphatically, by Clinton in 1993. And then most recently and importantly by Barack Obama as part of his stimulus plan in the wake of the Great Recession.
See, this is good information, isn't it?
Yeah. Right.
I'm learning stuff. Trust me, I'm going to be doing a news story in this. So, yes, sir, your name, please.
Hi, Kevin Wu from the Peterson Foundation. Thank you, panelists, for a very good discussion. I have two two brief questions. Do you think inequality is slowing economic growth today? And what are the channels by which inequality could slow economic growth today and in the future?
Well, I think it was John or one of you mentioned the report on the link between inequality and economic growth, which is something that we're, you know, really trying to learn something about right now as a, in its central way. The key sort of empirical fact that is incredibly important to keep in mind is that while the United States is the king of inequality today, that has not always been the case. In fact, you know, back before this sort of recent growth in the 1970s, the United States was situated with one of the highest rates of taxes on the very wealthy at 70, 80, 90%. We were an outlier compared to the high, you know, we had some of the highest rates among our peer rich countries in the world, and interestingly, lower levels of economic inequality. We've now transitioned to be one of the lowest taxing countries on the rich.
Definitely true. Both of them might be true. But the IMF is not from Berkeley or liberal. So the suggestions that, again, some of this is evolving as we talk, but there's a growing consensus that extreme inequality actually reduces economic growth and economic mobility.
And Michael.
But one of the reasons we have a great faculty at Berkeley is we are diverse and argue with each other a lot. And I don't happen to believe a word of the IMF report. It's just a cross-country correlation. There's no causality identified in it. And I do think when you talk about growth, you have to look. Consumption demand is an important part of it, but so is, well, so are exports, and so particularly is investment demand. And we have a situation where profits are high, but investment out of profits is actually pretty low and going into a lot of financial instruments and so forth. And I would point the finger more at that. And that we used to have a kind of...
We have lots of great ideas about how to address segregation in schooling and housing. I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about that.
So thanks for the question. Let me just make a quick comment to Michael's thing. I agree with what Michael just said. Also, but I think consumption is quite important. But one of the things also, Mike, you mentioned in terms of exports. So the United States consumer market is no longer the United States. So it may have, there's been a long belief that you have to have someone who can buy your products. But they don't have to be within your nation state anymore. Mm-hmm. And so we think that maybe we can sell a lot of stuff to China. We don't need U.S. workers. But I'll leave that for now. Yes, the segregation and it's easy to do. The states could do it. A lot of these programs we suggested actually could be done at the state level. And so, Richard, I agree. I appreciate you pushing us, saying be a little bit more robust. And hopefully we will be. And some of the work actually suggest that already, so I completely agree.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Your name, please.
Al Gentry of Cornerstone Real Estate Development in the Metro DC area. I wanted to talk a little bit about the empty boat, which I think was very eloquently presented by John.
But everybody doesn't have a boat.
Yeah, well, empty boat.
Is okay. Like
and the baby bond. Very quickly, I was running a conference in Miami, and John was the headliner, and Pierre Johns, I believe an economist, and his protege presented something called the baby bond. And even with an enlightened group like we have here today, everybody gasped. And the reason they gasped is because my numbers might not be correct, for I've never seen their policy paper, but they were saying, in light of the fact that a lot of kids have the empty boat, they come into our country penalized. Non-existent boat, $5,000 in wealth. So what these guys were presenting was something they called the baby bond. And their idea was that $40,000, it should be no lower than that, maybe it should be higher. Every baby born, I'm going to extrapolate a bit, to a family making less than $60,000.
Wow.
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 Your name, man.
That takes my breath away.
It does.
My name is Claudia Farris. I'm at George Mason University, Public School of Public Policy.
I am concerned about the fact that the Haas Institute is relying on existing research. Because the existing research is largely linear, has no dynamics with it, I think it would be an important contribution to methodology if you were to encourage the use of first, second, and third derivatives of change so that our policy universe can get ahead of these things and so we can understand why Charlotte, North Carolina is in the position that it's in. If you did the analysis in a dynamic way with those perspectives, people would understand what's going on. And the public policy universe really desperately needs to understand the difference between the linearity of economics, traditional economics, I don't know what kind of economist you are, and complexity theory in essence, okay? A difference in the circumstances embedded in policy will exacerbate the problem with equality. Because people don't know how to think about the difference between equality and sameness. So that's one thing I'd encourage your organization to pay attention to. And the fact that income subsidies are the best way.
Yes, sir. Your name, please.
My name is Lucas Turner Owens. I'm with Operation Hope. So the panel already touched on the impact of automation and technology and how it's pushing people out of certain jobs. And it was raised that we need better transitions to help folks find these new jobs that will become available. I wanted to ask if programs like Girls Who Code and high-quality STEM education offered in geographic areas where people are pushed into those type of jobs, like checkout attendants, toll booth workers, et cetera, are those the type of programs that we need to target domestically and then globally as places like Foxconn in China use automation to achieve the same objective? How are we preparing for that, you know, as workers come here and are pushed out of those jobs?
Yeah, so in Denmark, for example, they refer to this concept called flexicurity, where they want the workers to be flexible but to have some economic security at the same time. And the slogan is, don't protect the jobs, protect the workers. And they, so what they practically require you to take training if you lose your job because of automation or whatever other reason. I mean, they hunt you down in Denmark. And they spend probably 30 times what we do per, you know, dollar GDP on worker training. So it can be done. It's a little more expensive than just saying, oh, yeah, workers should get more training and so on. You have to put the money behind it. But it's worked extremely well in the Danish case, and that's been copied in a number of other countries, such as Germany, which, you know, still produces a lot of manufactured goods.
I think the thing to add to that also is that, you know, the kinds of policies that are post-job loss remedies, as Michael has talked about in terms of retraining, are very important. At the same time, while it's not sexy, it's fundamentally important to think about the longer run issue of investment in K-12 and post-K-12 education. And that is something that is very clear from the economic history and social history of the United States in terms of one of the sources. And our state is a very kind of excellent poster child for what a well-funded school system can do and a well-funded university system, and some concerns about what's happened to our funding of K-12 schools. So that is an integral part of this issue about how to remain flexible is to have the sort of general education that prepares workers for what we don't.
Research looked into this at all, because I see this as a major problem. Not only is it affecting the current generation, but their children, because their children see what their parents went through trying to hold on to a home, and they're still struggling, and they're paying now money for something, an asset that they no longer own, but they may have like $100,000 in debt that they'll have to pay over the next several years. I'd appreciate your response. Thank you.
So very quickly, a really important question. I have a more recent book out with a co-author called Where Credit is Due, which looks at the credit crisis. We are working with a number of communities, Detroit in particular and Richmond in particular. Richmond is looking at our reverse eminent domain of actually possibly taking those units that are underwater and through eminent domain and resetting the loans so that people can stay in their homes. It's not the ideal policy. We'd like to do this without going to court, although there's some complexities to which, because of the way loans are held now, it may be court may be necessary or not. We're also looking at Detroit and distressed cities. We have a report out called Underwater America, looking at all the number of cities that are underwater because of homes that are underwater and subject to foreclosure. We agree with you completely. We think a national policy, as you know, in the 30s, the principles were reset so people could stay in their homes.
Okay, well, let me tell you. The Parent PLUS loan issue, there's a vast majority of Americans, particularly minorities, who are on the Parent PLUS loan program. The Parent PLUS loan program used to go through the federal government where you didn't have to really have a stringent criteria to get these loans for your students to go to college. So then the government changed it, and the banks are now dealing with it, and there's a stringent criteria, very stringent. You cannot have that many blemishes on your credit report, so therefore it's locked out many children from having these loans. The CBC, Congressional Black Caucus, has been fighting with the administration about it. Arnie Duncan is working, they're watching the numbers to see how many schools have dropped. My university, Morgan State University, that's my alma mater, and Congressman Cummings happens to be on the Board of Regents there, and Kwesi Mfumeni, whatever. But they are working with him. They said they lost millions of dollars. Many colleges, particularly HBCUs, that are already hurting in this nation, have lost a lot of money. So, and that's along, I guess, were you talking about that as well? Okay.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Okay. this student debt thing is really horrible, and it has grown quite a bit, and it's really hampering quite a few people. I'm very proud of the fact that Berkeley students have much lower debt than most other universities, and it's in part because the University of California has a very generous scholarship program. We have a lot of people who get Pell Grants. We have more Pell Grants in Berkeley than the entire Ivy League, for example. And a big part of the student debt problem occurs at for-profit institutions, which are basically getting all these Pell Grants and student getting students to go to student loans. And the federal government is subsidizing, essentially, these schools, which are not providing the kind of education that will lead to a job. And there's already some tightening up going on of these institutions, which I'm glad to say. The other problem is that, for some reason, the Congress chose to decide that student debt was different from any other kind of debt. You know, other kinds of debt, you can declare bankruptcy. Mm-hmm. Student debt is becoming indentured servitude, which I thought was outlawed in the Constitution of the United States. But so, there's some major problems here and some major policy challenges. But again, they're not inevitable. They're definitely
of debt could be very sensible given the rewards that it generates in the long run. And I think that part shouldn't be forgotten.
Let me just add two things. One, we are working on issues of debt, and we actually are looking at not just student debt, but also homeowner debt, consumer debt, and municipal debt. And all those debts, all those forms of debts are new in the sense that they've been securitized, and the rules around them are actually quite different than they were 10 or 15 years ago. Also, I think it's very problematic, so maybe a slight shift from what Hillary just said. You know, when I went to school, it was basically free. I mean, and I'm old, but not that old. But the assumption was that education was a public good. I'm at University of California, Berkeley now, public university. Only 11% of our funding comes from the state. We're shifting to a private model. I just have a niece who started Harvard Medical School. Her debt going in is around $200,000. That starts distorting, and she'll probably make it back. She's as a doctor, but it's a huge mortgage. I mean, it's a house. And it means that a lot of children, a lot of students simply won't go. So we're distorting our whole society by privatizing even public schools and then securitizing those loans. So I think this is a huge problem that needs to be looked at very carefully. And the rules of the game, as Michael said, in terms of not being able to discharge debts through bankruptcy. There are other schools experiment with things in terms of students paying 10% of the first 5 years of employment, regardless to where it is. So if a student wants to go into public service, they can't pay a $200,000 loan. But if they go into Wall Street, they can. So there are ways to sort of think about this differently, and I think we need to.
Well, I would like to thank all of you for coming and thank each and every one of our panelists, John, Hillary, and Michael. I'm April Ryan. And I also want to let you know something before we turn it over to Valerie Wilson. It's interesting that we had this topic. I'm writing a book, and the book will be out February 2015. And the book is entitled The Presidency in Black and White, My Up-Close View of Three Presidents and Race in America. So we were right on.
Awesome.
Yes. So please look for the book. And I turn it over to Valerie. Thank you so much for being an attentive and great audience.
Thank you. So that brings this morning's event to a close, and it has indeed been an outstanding, very productive, very informative conversation. And I say that not in bragging. This was not an event that EPI put together. We're hosting. But I will say that it could not have been better said if we had said it ourselves. So thank you. Thank you again to our wonderful panel. And we look forward, EPI and the Haas Institute looks forward to working together as we move forward, because really there are a lot of issues that we agree upon. And having the event here in D.C. was not an accident. You know, they've done a lot of great research, but this is a place where a lot of people really take things and run with it to bring about the change that we need in our policies and in our communities. So thank you again for being here. Please pick up a copy of the report. There are EPI reports available out in the lobby area as well. And have a great day.